today we will be discussing about the retinoblastoma. So retinoblastoma is one of the very important topic. All the content of retinoblastoma are not important to you for an exam point of view, but some are important that as ocular emergency when you should refer the patient, and some are important as a theory part in your exam. So see different presentations, presenting pictures of the retinoblastoma. The child can present with like this type of white reflex, which is called the leukochoria, which can be unilateral or bilateral. So which can be present like this mass, or when you do the examination, you can see like this type of features. It is the most common primary intraocular malignancy of childhood, which arises from the primitive retinal cells. So all the white reflex in the eye is said retinoblastoma until proved otherwise. So you have to go through it, the detailed investigations, and to rule out the retinoblastoma. Because once you do the early diagnosis, you can save the child. So it is very important topic that when you should know when you should refer the patient. If any delay in referring or the hospital, if you don't know where you should refer it, that will hamper the child. So it is a very important topic for you all. It is the most common primary intraocular malignancy of the childhood, which arises from the primitive retinal cells. So it is 1 in 17,000 live births. Some book says that 1 in 15,000 live births. So about 3% of all the childhood cancer. It is about 3% of all childhood type of cancer. No sexual or racial predisposition. Mean age of diagnosis is usually 4 months, and bilateral disease in 40% in 12 months and unilateral in 60% in 24 months. So 90% of the cases is under the 3 years of age. So 6 months to 3 years, clinical features or the manifestations of the disease occurs because of the presence of primitive retinal cells at this age. Trilateral retinoblastoma or bilateral retinoblastoma with ectopic intracranial retinoblastoma, that is usually the pineal gland or the paracellular gland. If present, then it is called the trilateral retinoblastoma. So something about the history. The great scientists who have discovered the term and the disease, so let's know about them. Peter Spaulding of Amcester provided the descriptions of tumor resembling the retinoblastoma. So he describes that the substance is similar to brain tissues mixed with the thick blood and like cross stones in 1597. So James Wardrop, a Scottish surgeon, first recommended the inoculations of saving lives in patients of retinoblastoma in 1809. And Wardrop confirmed the origin from the undifferentiated retinal cells named retinoblastoma in 1900. So later on, the American Ophthalmology Society first adopted the term retinoblastoma in 1926. So what is the epidemiology? It is a cumulative lifetime incidence of 1 in 1500. So it depends upon book to book. At least you can follow one book like Kansky. In Parson, it is not given nicely. I think in Khurana also it's given this retinoblastoma. Annual incidence is highest in first few months of life, and yearly incidence decreases steadily. Extremely low by 6 years of age, and rarely diagnosed congenitally or even within the first 3 months of life. So bilateral retinoblastoma is more than 18 millimeter in unilateral cases. So retinoblastoma affects boys and girls with equal frequency and has no other racial prediction. So inheritance is 60 to 70% of retinoblastoma are unilateral, 30 to 40% are bilateral. In unilateral cases, only a single tumor is usually present in the affected eye. And in bilateral cases, multifocal tumors in both eyes are present. And retinoblastoma is generally the sporadic condition. So sporadic form of retinoblastoma are usually unilateral, and a small number have the prior family history of the retinoblastoma. That is, one of the parents is probably the survivor of the disease, and transmission of the disease in such families follows the genetic rule of autosomal dominant inheritance. So it is said that the cause of the disease is due to the mutation of gene found in chromosome, and that can affect the way of the cell grow and develop within the body. So that is two type of gene alterations in the RB1 and myosin are give rise to retinoblastoma. So RB1, that is one gene in children with the heritable genetic form of retinoblastoma, the mutation occurs in the RB1 gene of chromosome 13. So RB1 was the first tumor suppressor gene which cloned, and although the RB1 interact with over 100 cells protein, its negative regulator effects on the cell cycle principally arise from binding and interactivations of the transcription factor E2F, thus repressing the transcription of gene which are required for the S phase. So it's mutations of RB1, and the defective RB1 genes can be inherited from either the parents. In some children, however, the mutation occurs in the early stages of fetal development, and the expressions of RB1 alleles in autosomal dominant with 90% penetrance. So inheritance form of retinoblastoma are most likely to be bilateral. And in addition, inherited uni or bilateral retinoblastoma may be associated with pineoblastoma and other malignant midline supratentorial primitive neuroectodermal tumors, so which is called the trilateral retinoblastoma. So not all the retinoblastoma causes with the RB1 inactivations. There are cases reported with only one RB1 mutation or even two functional RB1 alleles, which indicates other oncogenic lesions of retinoblastoma. So some somatic amplifications of the myosin oncogenes is responsible for some cases of non-hereditary type of retinoblastoma, which are early onset, which are aggressive, and which are unilateral. So MONC can act as a transcription factor and promotes proliferations by regulating the expressions of cell cycle gene. So although MINC amplifications accounted for only 1.4% of retinoblastoma cases, research identified within 18% of infants diagnosed at least 6 months of age. So medial gene at diagnosis of MINC retinoblastoma was 4.5 months compared with 24 months of those who had non-familiar unilateral disease with two RB1 gene mutation. So what are the clinical manifestations, or what can you see in a child, or when what a child guardians or parents see in the baby's eyes and brings to you? The features are leukocoria, which is almost 60%, strabismus 20%, red painful eye 7%, poor vision 5%, asymptomatic 3%, orbital cellulitis 3%, unilateral midriasis 2%, heterochromia iridis 1%, and hyphema 1%. So these are the different symptoms or signs which you see in a child, or which guardians or parents see in a child and brings to you. So leukocoria 60%, which is a lack of red reflex. So when you shine a light with a direct ophthalmoscope in the pupil, you will see normally the red reflex. But if that reflex is absent, and if you see the white reflex, So that is called the leukocoria. So lack of red reflex of the eye in large tumors, retinal detachment, retrolenteal mass, or vitreous opacifications due to tumor cells, which is often noticed by the mother. So you don't know what is the cause for the leukocoria. There are several causes for the leukocoria, which is a differential diagnosis of the leukocoria will be frequently asked to you in your exam. So you should know at least 5 to 10 causes of the leukocoria. Among them, retinal detachment, retrolenteal mass, or vitreous opacification, these are few. So there will be leukocoria. Strabismus, that is the misalignment of the visual axis, that is the eye will be deviated one side. So disruptions of the fusional reflex due to the loss of central vision from the tumor in the macula. So if there is a tumor in the macula, then the child wants to find the visual vision. So they turn the eye towards the either side. So you can see the strabismus. So whenever there is a strabismus and if there is a good vision, suppose 6, 6, 6, 9, then at the early stage, if the parents brings the child to you, then you can miss out at this stage. So all the strabismus cases should be dilated, should be done dilated fundoscopy and should be evaluated the endophytic or exophytic type of the retinoblastoma. Rubiaceous iridis means a new vessels which is seen in the iris, which is present in 70% of the cases, will be seen in the extensive stage of the disease. Heterochromia, that is the different color of the iris, spontaneous hyphema, so blood in the anterior chamber, glaucoma, that is neovascular glaucoma or angle closure glaucoma can occur, and pseudohypopyon, that is a pus in the anterior chamber can be there, but this pus is not due to the ulcer, this is due to the seeding of the anterior chamber in the endophytic or diffuse infiltrating tumors, because the tumors cell settle there, resulting in the hypopyon. So it is called the pseudohypopyon. And pain due to the glaucoma or inflammations and proptosis of the eye can be seen. So these are very important things which you will be asked to you in your exam. What are the clinical features of the retinoblastoma? So differential diagnosis is persistent hyperplastic primary vitreous, Coats disease, toxocariasis, retinopathy of prematurity. See, the eye will look like a cat's eye appearance. So in the screening or when you see the child, what the things you should observe? So screening of for retinoblastoma should be the part of well baby screening for newborn during the first 3 months of life, to include the red reflex, to Hertzberg test and eye examination. So what is red reflex? Checking for the normal reddish orange reflections from the eye's retina with the ophthalmoscope or retinoscope for about 30 centimeters, from a distance about 30 centimeters or 1 foot. So usually done in a dim light or in the dark room. So whenever we will take a direct ophthalmoscope, or we will, with the help of the retinoscope also from a distance, certain distance, 30 centimeters, 1 meter, then you will see the red reflex in the baby's eye. We will say that the red glow is intact. So that is a red reflex, and the cornea light reflex, which is called the Hertzberg reflex. It is also very important, Hertzberg reflex. So if the Hertzberg reflex is present at the center, then it is said that the eye is aligned. Checking for the symmetrical reflections of the beam of light in the same spot of each eye when a light is shining into each cornea to help determine whether the eyes are crossed. So whether the eyes are deviated, so it can be seen with the help of this corneal light reflex. When you throw a light and you will see the at the center of the eye, there will be the reflex. So eye examination, checking for any structural abnormalities. So what are the pattern of the growth of these tumors? It can be the endophytic, that is inside growth, exophytic, that is outside growth, or mixed type, both the endo and exotypic, or it can be the diffuse infiltrative type. So endophytic is arises from the inner layer of retina, which fills the vitreous cavity, anteriorly reaches the aqueous venous channels, and may permit through the lymphatic channels and visual disturbance or white light reflex. So endophytic means arise from the retinal layer, inner layer, and there will be the vitreous cavity is filled. Exophytic is arise from the outer layer of the retina, and it fills the subretinal space and posteriorly causes serous retinal detachment and choroidal invasion through the Bruch's membrane, and proptosis or retinal detachment occurs. So endophytic or exophytic, when you dilate the pupil and see in the vitreous, then that is endophytic. When you see there is a proptosis or there is invasions through the choroids, it is the exophytic, or it can be mixed. Most common growth pattern is mixed type. And diffuse infiltratic is no mass, only the sign of endophthalmitis. Average years is 6 years, or pseudohypophyne resembling the inflammatory regions, or diagnosed diluted or mostly difficult unilateral or sporadic type. So diffuse infiltratic type has the mascaroid features, that will be the features of some other things disease, and the original pattern of the disease is misguided. Like the patient can present with the uveitis, but there can be the retinoblastoma, or there can be the hypopyon, and the presenting features will be the hypopyon, it would be retinoblastoma. Actually, that is not the hypopyon, but that is the pseudohypopyon. So there are the pattern of the growth is mostly four types. So see the endophytic pattern in this picture, you can see the growth is inside, and over here the exophytic lesions, the growth is outside. So advanced proptosis secondary to optic nerve and orbital extension, that is the scleral miceri vein, and atypical presentations can be pseudohypopyon, spontaneous hyphema, vitreous hemorrhage, thysis bulbi is the shrinkage of the volume of the eye, which results in soft eye, and where the ocular structure cannot be identified, and preseptal cellulitis, that is the inflammation which do not extend beyond the orbital septum, and orbital cellulitis is the inflammation which extend beyond the orbital septum. So what are the root of the spread of the disease? So there is the direct local tumors infiltrations that can be the subarachnoid space of optic nerve, anterior spread to the conjunctiva, iris, and extraocular tissues. It can be the hematogenous dissemination. So choroidal invasions, it can be CSF dissemination to the brain and spine, to the lymphatic disseminations, and hematogenous disseminations from the orbital bones or the lymphatic invasion. So different route of spread. Presentations is white, round, oval, dome-shaped retinal mass. So how does the mass look like? It is a round, oval, or dome-shaped, and it is attract the retinal basement membrane, or it can be the very small tumors, or it can be the large tumors, or it can extend through the RPE or into the vitreous. So any type it can be. So it is a white dome shape. So if you see them, this is a tumors involving the intraretinal tumors. It is involving the macular area, which you will see the opaque yellow white lesions. And this is a retinoma which is spontaneously arrested retinoma with vascularity, which is, it looks like grayish white sprinkles surrounding the chorioretinal atrophy, so, and the RP hypertrophy. Now, what are the pathological features which when you will see the histopathology finding, which is also one of the important questions for you for your exam. Histological finding. I think you have already discussed the histological finding in the first year and second year. So malignant neuroepithelial cell, which is called the retinoblast, which arise within the immature retina. So retinoblast, large basophilic nucleus and scanty cytoplasm. So cellular necrosis and intralesional classification, that is larger tumors. So tissue differentiations occurs producing the Flexner-Winstein type rosette or the Homer white rosette or a fluted type. So these are the three typical or a pseudo rosette. So these are the typical histological findings, histopathological findings of this retinoblastoma. Flexner-Winstein rosette, Homer white rosette, fluted and pseudo rosette. So when you see this picture, histopathological pictures, it looks like this. So Flexner-Winstein rosette pattern is the columnar cells around the central lumen, also seen in the medulloepithelioma. So there will be the central lumen and the cells will be columnar type, means little bit taller cells will be there with the central space. And the Homer white, there will be the rosette around the central neuromuscular core and other features like the neuroblastoma, medulloepithelioma and medulloblastoma also you will see like this. So this is a like flower pattern would be there, and a fluted type is a tumor cells with a pear shape eosinophilic. So eosinophilic processes projecting through it will be seen over here. So you just remember the three types of the pattern: Flexner, Winsteiner, Homer white and fluted type and pseudo rosette. Now coming to the differential diagnosis of the leukochoria, which we have already discussed: Coats disease, persistent hyperplastic primary vitreous, ocular toxocariasis, secretorial retinopathy of prematurity, familial exudative vitreoretinopathy, incontinential pigmentary retinopathy, and Norrie's disease. So some of the differential diagnoses for the vitreous seething or discrete retinal tumors, misleads the diagnosis for the give the features which is called the mascarite syndromes are pars planitis, microbial endophthalmitis, leukemic infiltrates or astrocytoma of retina, medulloepithelioma, and retinal capillaries hemangioma. So at least you remember the differential diagnosis of the leukochoria. So I think this slide we will not discuss. So coming to the staging diagnosis and treatment of the thing. So the staging, the diagnosis depends mainly on the ultrasonography, X-ray, CT scan, and MRI, and mostly the clinical features. So ultrasonography, that is more than 10 to 15 millimeter multiple foci of calcification, you will see the shadow, the sclera, and the orbital soft tissues on reducing gain reflective reflection process. So what you will see, so like this type of features you will see in case of the B scan in the retinoblastoma. So first of all, these are the anterior segment, and this is a vitreous, and this is a retina. So you will see the retina features like this. So the B scan ultrasonography of retinoblastoma, where you will see the solid posterior intraocular mass and containing the strong particulate reflectivity. So you can see over here the skin A scan is not here. So A scan which gives more reflectivity in this hyperechoic shadow. Indirect ophthalmoscope. So it is a very important finding. Most of the finding or diagnosis is done clinically, and to prove that only we go for the histopathology or other investigation. So dilated fundus examination under anesthesia is very important. Intraocular pressure and anterior segment neovascularization is seen. Pseudohypopyon and hyphema and the sign of inflammations are seen. Bilateral fundus examination with the 360 degrees scleral depression. It is very, very important to see all the peripheral areas of the retina. CT scan, which gives infiltrating retinoblastoma, that is a tumor multicentrality and extensive seating into the vitreous. So they will give the white calcified area can be seen in the CT scan, that we will be able to see that any seatings are present in the vitreous or not. And the MRI, which gives the if there is an extension to the optic nerve, then which can be seen in the MRI. So in the CT, you will see like this type of the features, the calcified lesion over here. And systemic evaluation, that is the germinal retinoblastoma, have the strong tendency to develop non-retinoblastoma malignancy. So primary non-retinoblastoma, intracranial malignancy, either a pineoblastoma or an ectopic intracranial retinoblastoma. Most common neoplasm. So it can cause the headache and other neurological symptoms. Central nervous system evaluations. And ophthalmoscopy frequently reveals the papilloedema referred to as the trilateral retinoblastoma. So this type is mostly fetal. So baseline systemic evaluations in the retinoblastoma is the complete pediatric history and physical examination, blood for the complete blood count, MRI and CT of the brain, especially in bilateral or familial cases, to look for the ectopic intracranial retinoblastoma. Lumbar puncture for the cerebrospinal fluid analysis, bone marrow aspirations or biopsy, and bone scan for the other type of the retinoblastoma. So stages of the disease, depending upon the size of the tumor or the area involved in the retina. So depending upon that, it is divided into the different stages of the disease. So group 1 to group 5, and group 1 is a very favorable prognosis where there are solitary tumors small than 4 discs diopter in size and or behind the equator, and multiple tumors non greater than 4 discs diopter in size. So depending upon the size of the tumor, which is compared with that of the discs diopter. And the stage 2 is also favorable prognosis where there is solitary tumor, means single tumor, 4 to 10 discs diopter in size at or behind the equator, and multiple tumors, 4 to 10 discs diopter in size all or behind the equator. And the stage 3 is the doubtful prognosis, that is any lesion anterior to the equator and solitary tumors larger than 10 discs diopter behind the equator. And the stage 4 is unfavorable prognosis, that is multiple tumors some greater than 10 discs diopter and any lesion extending anterior to the ora serrata. And a very unfavorable prognosis is massive tumor involving more than half of the retina and vitreous seeding. So any tumor which is single tumors, and if it is less than 4 discs diopter, then it is it has got the good prognosis. So there is some classification, international classifications, which is called the SILT classification, which have divided the group 1, group B, group A, B, C. For the different for the treatment purpose, which and for the prognostic purpose of the disease. So group A, it is small tumors, retinoblastoma less than 3 millimeter in size in the basal dimension and thickness. Group B is large tumors of more than 3 millimeter, macular location less than 3 to fovea, and juxtapapillary location less than 1.5 millimeter to the disc and clear subretinal fluid. And C is focal. Seats, it is again C1, C2, and C3, like this D and E. So what are the prognostic factors for the disease? Is there is optic nerve invasion is most important poor prognostic factor. So optic nerve, if you see in the MRI, massive invasion of the choroids, if there is choroidal extension, if there is an extraorbital extension, if it is a poorly differentiated tumors, if the anterior chamber invasions, if the large tumors with the venous vitreous seeding, it is a rubiosis, glaucoma, or a bilateral tumors which behaves poorly as mortality, and if it is a trilateral retinoblastoma. If these features are present, then they have the poor prognosis. So what is the management of the disease? The primary goal is to save the life of the child and stabilize of the organ and function. Second is we have to save the eye, and secondary and tertiary center and multidisciplinary approach. So one setting is not enough, and individual depends upon the age of the child, laterality, location, staging, systemic conditions, overall progressions, and cost effectiveness. So these all things depends upon the management and the prognosis of the disease. So the current suggestive protocol is the intraocular tumors, that is the international classifications group of ABCD, which we have discussed. So they give the different type of the therapy, like the focal cryotherapy, transpupillary thermotherapy, standard 6-cycle chemoreductions and focal therapy, and other focal therapy with the plague radiotherapy or the external beam radiotherapy or inoculations. So depending upon the group which we have discussed, the treatment modality depends upon. So what are the treatment modalities? You should know it. So the treatment option for the intraocular retinoblastoma is the intravenous chemotherapy, inoculations of the eye, radiation therapy, which can be the external beam radiation therapy or the plague radiotherapy, laser therapy, that is the photocoagulations or the transpupillary thermotherapy, cryotherapy or observation. So chemotherapy, what are the chemotherapy which you give? The combinations of the carboplatin, epoposide or related drugs like vincristin, these are the regimen, and in some center the cyclosporine is added to this regimen to reduce the multi-drug resistance that occurred in many retinoblastoma. So cycle treatment for about every 3 to 4 weeks for 6 or more cycles, and most intraocular retinoblastoma lesions is given including the intravitreal. And partially regressed tumors still viable following the second cycle of chemotherapy. Any new tumors during the course of chemotherapy must be treated by obliterative local therapy such as cryotherapy, laser therapy or episcleral plague radiation therapy. So this is a picture showing before the treatment of chemotherapy and after the treatment of the chemotherapy. Inoculations remains an important therapeutic option for that child who have unilateral advanced intraocular disease. Inoculation is sometimes recommended for both eyes in child who have bilateral far advanced diseases not amenable in any eye preserving therapy, or for more severely affected eyes in asymmetric bilateral cases. So if inoculation is performed, the ophthalmic surgeon should attempt to obtain the long sections of optic nerve during the surgery. So along with the eyeball, we will take out the part of the optic nerve also. So the principal route of exit of the tumor cells from the eye is along the optic nerve. So prior to pathological studies have shown that inoculation is usually curative if an optic nerve section is longer than 5 mm is obtained with the globe. So it is very important, and if possible, the ophthalmic surgeon should attempt to obtain an optic nerve section of 10 to 15 mm in every case. Insertion of the orbital implant at the time of inoculation appears to be appropriate, except when there is a strong likelihood of residual tumor in the orbit. So always along with the inoculations, we implant the orbital implant over there. So what are the special considerations for the inoculations is we do the minimum manipulations, avoid the perforations of the eye because the tumor can spread, harvest long, that is 15 millimeter of optic nerve stump, inspect the inoculated eye for the macroscopic extraocular extension or optic nerve involvement, harvest the fresh tissue for the genetic studies, place and primary implant, and avoid the biointegrations implant if post-operative radiotherapy is necessary. So there are different types of the implant for the cosmetic purpose. So these are the orbital implants. So we go next to external beam radiotherapy. So external beam radiotherapy is most commonly employed regional eye preserving the therapy for this disease was external beam radiation therapy. And other side effects of the external beam radiotherapy are cataract, dry eye, radiation, neuropathy, neovascularizations. Then we go for the plague radiation therapy. So before the treatment and after the treatment of the plague regressions radiotherapy. So this is a suture of the sclera is done. And the laser therapy, it is photocoagulation, so it can be due to the transpupillary thermotherapy also through the pupillary region. And the photocoagulations, if the photocoagulation, the argon green laser is given or through the indirect ophthalmoscope delivery system, and the relatively long exposure durations of 1 second or more to continuous exposure. So there can have the side effect like the transient serous retinal detachment, retinal vascular occlusion, retinal hole, tractions, or pre-retinal fibrosis, or the large visual field defect. Transpupillary thermotherapy is an intra-red laser beam of 810 nanometer is given. And cryotherapy, it is a transscleral cryotherapy, is an obliterative focal treatment which destroyed the targeted intraocular tissues by means of the freezing. So instillated retinal cryoprobe will be there, and through that we delivered it through the triple freeze and thaw method is applied. So it has a different side effect like transient RD and retinal tear. So this it will form an iceberg like pattern which encompasses the entire tumor, and if the tumor is small, or a portion of the tumor if the tumor is large. So this probe is then deactivated and the iceberg is allowed to thaw. This cycle is repeated once, that is a double freeze thaw method, or twice, that is triple freeze thaw method at each site. So it is a painful condition, so we should give under the anesthesia, and if the tumor is larger, can be encompassed entirely by the single freeze repeated every 2 to 4 weeks. So cryo applied 2 to 3 hours prior to the chemo delivery of drugs. That okay. So this is the end of the retinoblastoma. So thank you all for your attention and wish you a happy Deepavali. So in the next class, I will start some other topic.